Let's continue. Have you ever, listened to the news and you'll hear somebody talking about terrorism? Well, it's a pretty bad thing. Terrorism is terrorizing people. And one of the greatest terrorizer in all time, the best at terrorizing, would be Genghis Khan. He was a Mongol, and he was considered the emperor of all men back in that time that we're talking about. And we're talking about the 1100s to the 1200s. He was considered the scourge of the East. He terrorized China and Japan and even into the Muslim nations. In 1167, he was born. His name was Temujin, and he was from the tribe called the Yaka tribe. Back in that time, they had all these little tribes that roamed the Gobi Desert, and they weren't very united. But Genghis Khan was very good at uniting all these small tribes. He was really good, mostly at conquering and killing, even in the midst of this bone-chilling, terrible weather in the Gobi Desert. He wore furs and leather and rubbed his skin with grease to keep the wind away. He ate foxes and rabbits and anything else, and go with long days without food. Most of the Mongols did this. If they were in danger of starving, they would take their horses, and especially Genghis Khan, and he would take their horses and he would cut the vein of their horse, and they would drink their horse's blood and then close the veins back again. Pretty bad, pretty bad. He would kill merchants and steal their goods. They were like bandits. They would attack the Chinese villages on the northern edge of Mongolia. Genghis Khan wanted more than ever to band the Mongols together so they could take over China. His greatest thing was to take over the whole Chinese empire, which was huge. You see, the Great Wall had been built to keep out the Mongols. On the other side of the wall was a big city called Beijing, a beautiful city that had warm houses, soft beds, plenty of food, and a lot of riches, a lot of gold. So he said, "We need to attack this city." So Genghis Khan, before he could attack the city, had to unite all of these clans, and savagely he did this. He said, "Anyone who doesn't follow me will be killed." And he said, basically, the greatest joy in his whole life was to kill my rivals and steal their possessions. And so they were really scared. They mostly surrendered to him. Even the Mongols, which were some of them were pretty tough, the clans decided they wanted to surrender him and let him be the leader. So he did. One time he'd also terrorize and try to terrorize him by other ways. Like one time he killed this man and he put him in his tent, and then he snuck him out this little smoke hole in the back so they didn't know. And when they came in to get him, he had disappeared. And he said, "Oh, the gods are for me. Did you see what happened here? The same will happen to me or to you if you don't follow me." Very, very scary guy. So he led the Mongols against China. They swarmed down from the north, they broke through that great wall, and they conquered Beijing. Then they turned their armies to the west and went against the Islamic Empire, which was huge. And one by one, each city, each town, each Muslim country surrendered to Genghis Khan. They were afraid to death, one historian said. In fact, there was a Mongol, and they think probably it was Genghis Khan, that came upon these 18 Muslim guys. And as he came on, he said, "Okay, you guys get off your horses and just tie each other up. And you guys can all tie each other up." And then one of the guys said, "What? What are we doing? It's only one guy, and there's like 18 of us." And so he broke through, and they ended up jumping on the horses. They were scared to death. They ran away and told everyone how terrible the Mongols are, and especially Genghis Khan. They were afraid to death of him. No wonder he could conquer such a huge empire, as everyone was afraid of him. Well, as he conquered more and more, he still wasn't, he wasn't basically that healthy. He ended up probably because he's drinking the horse's blood, but I don't know. But he ended up, as he went back to was going back to Mongolia, he got very sick and he died. And then they took his body and they had this great funeral procession. And during the funeral procession, if anyone looked at where the funeral procession was going, if they would kill them. So they would not know where Genghis Khan was buried. I tell you, what a scourge he was. Well, he died, and his son took over, and his son's name was, I have his name here. I have to look at it because I'm not really familiar. His name was Ogote. Ogote was basically, he wasn't such a terrorized as much as Genghis Khan. He built the capital of Karakorkum in north central Mongolia, and he started taxing the people wherever he went, and he sent out scary tax collectors to collect money. He also brought Persians in, Persian Muslims. He recruited them as physicians. And he also set up a big observatory and a calendar through the Persians. He invaded China on the Yangtze River, and he also went in and invaded Persia, Armenia, Georgia, Russia. In 1240, he conquered the great city of Kiev of the Russians. In 1241, he moved into Eastern Europe. He was 3,600 miles from his homeland. When he went in to conquer the area that's now Hungary and Poland, and he died. There's a lot of confusion then, like who's going to be the next Khan? And they ended up settling on one of Genghis Khan's grandsons, and his name was Kublai Khan. And we're going to talk more about Kublai Khan, because we're going to see there's a lot written by him, because there was an Italian guy that went into this area and wrote books on his travels, and his name was Marco Polo, and he's going to write about Kublai Khan. So stay tuned. Also, Marco Polo not only wrote and lived under Kublai Khan, but he also shared the gospel with him. I thought that was pretty amazing. Who knows? Maybe we'll even see Kublai Khan in heaven.